of the Worldwide Armed Forces Radio and Television Service, AFTV-8, Sondastrom Air Base, Greenland.
Tonight, watch the change of command ceremony, learn about Black History Month, and more on Sondy's Spotlight. Now here's your host, Airman First Class Rick Sarche.
Good evening and welcome to Sondy's Spotlight. That's the new name for what used to be known as Kaleidoscope. It's basically the same program with information for and about our local community with some new additions, like Club and BX News. And to start off tonight's program, Master Sergeant Craig Knutson had a conversation with Colonel Jeffrey L. Gullett earlier this month.
In this portion of Sondy Spotlight, we focus on Colonel Jeffrey L. Gullett, commander of the 1015th Air Base Group, Sondastrom Air Base, Greenland, from February 13, 1985 until February 19, 1986. Master Sergeant Craig Knutson talked with Colonel Gullett about his year at Sondastrom.
Sir, how do you feel this year went for Sondastrom, and what do you see in its future?
Well, Craig, I think basically it's been a very super year. I think there's been an awful lot happening that we can all be proud of. I think one of the things that has come about that's fairly significant, I think, is all the construction projects that have been going on. The facilities upgrade program, we've seen new changes in dormitories. We're building a new transient facility, the Arctic Hotel. An awful lot of improvements. I think it's been a good year for me. I've enjoyed being with the people, and one of the things I think that things that has come across to me is it's a much busier place than I ever expected at Sondastrom. As far as the future, I think we can continue to seeing a lot of new changes coming about, both in personnel, which is a constant thing here at Sondastrom. And we'll continue to see more facilities upgrades and hopefully improvement in quality of life type projects.
Will the new commander be faced with any challenges unique to Sondastrom Air Base?
Well, I don't know if they're all unique to Sondastrom, but probably one of the challenges that faced me, as well as probably all previous commanders, is trying to keep track of all the visitors that come through the base here. It's much busier than I ever anticipated, and I think he'll find the same thing. I think probably one of his initial challenges will be a very busy schedule. He comes in and he'll have the change of command, and then trying to get, you know, learn everybody initially, and then he's also got a commander's conference in Copenhagen coming up in April. We'll probably have to go back to the States for an on-scene commander's course, and so it's very easy to get behind very quickly if you're not ready to meet those challenges.
Turning from the past to the future, what does it hold for you?
Warm weather, I hope. Well, of course, the immediate future is to get back to the States, see the wife, relax, play a little golf, and then on to sunny California. I have not really made any plans past. I am required to stay at least 1 year there, and I'll probably just evaluate the situation and see what job potential is there, how things are going before I make a decision whether to, you know, stay a little longer or not. Long range plans, probably all of us have those, is to settle down in one place eventually, if I can stand it, and, you know, build a home and do the things that we kind of shoot for. It might be harder than we expect after, you know, 20 some odd years of moving around, but I think that's one of the goals, and I think eventually I'd like to go into business for myself.
Sir, from the Sondastrom Air Base community, good luck in all things.
Thank you very much, Craig.
We've been talking to Colonel Jeffrey L. Gullett, the 1015th Air Base Group Commander. I'm Master Sergeant Craig Knutson for AFTV 8.
And a going-away dinner was held for Colonel Gullett on the 15th. For a look at that, here's Airman Diane Fisher.
Colonel Jeffrey L. Gullett, the former commander of the 1015th Air Base Group, left Sondestrom on February 20th. A farewell dinner was held in his honor February 15th at the Fox and Hare Club. After the dinner, friends and co-workers took the platform for a roast and to present gifts to Colonel Gullett, both sentimental and bizarre.
There are a lot of things that you've done wrong in your life, and and one of them is consistently and constantly and always calling this the famous picture of Black Ridge. Well, actually, this is not a famous picture of Black Ridge. This isn't even close to Black Ridge. This is probably 2 miles away from Black Ridge. This is the famous picture taken from Black Ridge, not of Black Ridge. A minor point, I'm sure. I mean, after all, I have to come to work every day with a guy that said, "Did you know I'm a colonel? Look at these."
Sir, 22 of these cigarettes are yours, and right now I'm going to go ahead and give them to you.
Hey, Doc. Are we going to have one together? Or
yes, sir.
Doc's going to quit smoking because after he had to buy a cart.
I got late. This is Captain Greenwood here. It's time for you to go goodbye. But we all know he's a hell of a good guy. But sir, it's time for me to retire and get on out of here. You and I will go to McGuire and what is it called? Milliger? I talked to my friend who said that it's going to take a certain thing to keep us here one more day. It's called a giant earthquake.
And then it was Colonel Gullett's turn to say a few words.
It's been terrific working with all of you, the military. I think one of the things that I've kind of been striving for the entire year, and I think all of us have accomplished, and that's a togetherness in the Sondestrom community, and I really think that we've accomplished that. The military folks, I can't say enough about those who are here now and those who have departed. I've had a lot of super people and a lot of super people that are here now that have given me all the support that I could ever ask for, and I truly and sincerely appreciate it, all the way from the group folks to the AFRTS and also the 2004. I couldn't have asked for any more support than I've gotten from them, and from the bottom of my heart, I appreciate it. And also including the 4700th. We've always had, we've had two representatives here, and we've always gotten the utmost support in, from those folks. From the civilian side, all of you have been just great, and I appreciate the entire year. And the bottom line, I've done a lot of things here, go from Muscat's Bay to the ice cap, tracking caribou, and just having a wonderful time. From Danish American Day, going to the Commander's Conference in Copenhagen, and all the great things, but no matter, bottom line is, everything you say and you do, they don't make it. The people that make the entire tour and have made my tour are the people here, and that includes all of you, and I appreciate the dinner night and the nice gifts, and I want to thank you all for making Sondestrom a beautiful experience. Thank you very much.
Reporting for Sondy Spotlight, I'm Airman Diane Fisher.
Coming up on Sondy Spotlight, we'll take a look at the change of command ceremony right after this.
This month at the Caribou Club, from now until March 13th, the band The Lovebirds will play a variety of music for your enjoyment. And if you like country rock, the Caribou Club welcomes another DOD band, the Hambo Latham Show. They'll be playing from March 18th to the 23rd. Finishing up the month of March is the band Mystique, and they'll be playing from March 26th until April 10th. And as a special reminder, Sunday nights at the Fox and Hare Club is Coat and Tie Night. And that's the latest in club news for this edition of Sondy Spotlight.
Thanks, Ted. Now, Airman Tim Hill highlights the change of command ceremony which took place earlier this month.
The change of command ceremony was conducted February 19th at the base theater. Colonel Jeffrey L. Gullett relinquished command of the 1015th Air Base Group to Lieutenant Colonel Larry A. Doak. Colonel Philip E. Brocker, 1st Space Wing Commander, officiated the ceremony.
Attention to orders. Department of the Air Force Headquarters, 1st Space Wing Air Force Space Command, Peterson Air Force Base, Colorado. Special Order G-29, dated 12 February 1986, under the provisions of AFR 3554 and 1st Space Wing Air Force Space Command letter, Lieutenant Colonel Larry A. Doak assumes command of the 1015th Air Base Group, Air Force Space Command, Sondrestrom Air Base, Greenland, effective 19 February 1986. Philip E. Brocker, Colonel, United States Air Force Commander.
Sir, I relinquish command.
Sir, I assume command.
Colonel Gullett is on his way to March Air Force Base, California, where he will be assigned to the 26th Air Division as Deputy Director of the Region Operational Control Center. Lieutenant Colonel Doak is a native of Seattle, Washington. His past assignments have included Thailand, RAF Alconbury, England, New Orleans, Louisiana, Shepherd Air Force Base, Texas, Elmendorf Air Force Base, Alaska, and Washington, D.C. Lieutenant Colonel Doak comes to Sondrestrom Air Base from his most recent assignment as Space Command's first Director of Transportation. After the ceremony, Colonel Brocker noted,
"It's a pleasure for me to be here and give the command to Lieutenant Colonel Larry Doak. He comes highly recommended. He's a superb leader. You'll find him to be very sensitive to your needs. Have an open communications with him and let him parlay your desires and your needs back to Colorado Springs, and we'll address those and support you 100% from there."
Colonel Gullett was presented with a plaque of appreciation and made a few comments about his tour here.
"We've already had several dinners and occasions, and I hope I've expressed at various other things how much I do appreciate the Sondrestrom community, and I say that because I think I have seen more of a community come together here and work for the betterment of all of us who are living here at Sondrestrom. I think we've faced a few challenges since we've been here, and I hope we've overcome them. And it has indeed been a pleasure for me to serve here at Sondrestrom, and I know Colonel Doak will enjoy his tour here, and it'll be just like Colonel Barker said, it's over before you know it. It only seems like yesterday I was up here for a similar type event, saying hello and welcome, and now it's time to depart. But it's been a beautiful year. And for all of you, for your support and cooperation, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you very much."
Lieutenant Colonel Doak spoke on some recommendations Colonel Gullett made as to what to expect as commander of Sondrestrom Air Base.
First of all, he said that a commander has to control rumors. And I know that Sondrestrom has been faced with changes in the past, and we can always say that change is inevitable. And I shall make it my purpose to keep you informed of what those changes are and try to keep the rumors to a minimum. Secondly, he said a new commander has to be flexible. And I think Colonel Leathers down here in the front row can attest to the fact that I tend to be pretty flexible. I think that being flexible, it means also that you have to listen to your people. And if it doesn't seem that things are going on the right direction to you, please let me know, and you'll see that I do have some flexibility. And thirdly, and probably most important, I think, here at a remote tour, Colonel Gullett said that you have to take care of your people. And to me, that means Danish and American alike. And I certainly plan to make this a very pleasant tour. Certainly, we have the facilities to do that and take care of those kinds of people problems to make it all that much better.
A reception was held at the Fox and Hare Club to say farewell and best wishes to Colonel Gullett, and at the same time welcome Lieutenant Colonel Doak as the new 1015th Air Base Group Commander. For Sandy Spotlight, I'm Airman Tim Hill.
Along with all the local events which made the month quite busy, February is nationally recognized as Black History Month. And with more on that, here's Airman Ted Northrup.
I'm here with Major Watson from headquarters. He's Director of Operations and Training. And tonight we'll be talking about Black History Month. Tell me, Major, who established Black History Month?
Carter G. Woodson, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, as a matter of fact. In 1915, he established what is known as the Association for the Study of Negro Life in America. Since then, it's been retitled Association for the Study of Afro-American Life in America. And when I first came into the military about 13 years ago, it wasn't a Black History Month observance, it was a Black History Week observance, and it was centered around the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and George Washington. I'm sorry, Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. Since then, it's been expanded within the last, I guess, 6 or 7 years to a total month observation.
Why was it established?
The fact is that the American Negro has not been documented well in the American history books. Okay, it's either been distorted or ignored, and that's the whole reason behind the month's observation.
Why study the history of the Black American?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. The Negro has taken an active role in the development of the United States, along with other races and nationalities. But the Black's contributions have been, well, ignored, or in some cases misrepresented, okay? America has a rich legacy of art, literature, music, sports, philosophy from the American Negro. A study of American history would be totally inadequate without including the contributions of the Black American.
Well, thank you very much, Major. I've been talking with Major Watson from headquarters about Black History Month. I'm Airman Ted Northrup for Sandy Spotlight.
Next, Barbara Thorberg, a professional bowler, visited Sandy this month. We'll have that story and more on Sandy Spotlight after this message.
Starting on March 7th, money orders purchased at the base exchange may be made for up to $499.99. And the money orders will now cost 50 cents apiece. If there's a special item you need at the BX and they don't have it, just ask and they'll try to fill your request.
The Sonderstrom community welcomed a special visitor this month who had a few helpful tips for one of Sandy's favorite pastimes. Airman Diane Fisher was there.
On Wednesday, February 5th, a handful of bowlers gathered at Sonderstrom's bowling alley to attend a clinic held by WIBC national champion average record holder Barbara Thorberg. During the two clinics, Barbara discussed ways to improve your game by learning to control where the ball will go. She used several examples, and all included focusing on your target. Barbara also talked about the difference between a thrower and a bowler.
But the difference between letting you be a thrower or a bowler is to take your bowling ball at your hand and totally relax your hand. Just put it in your hand, totally relax your hand. It should not fall off, okay? And when I say relaxed, I don't mean your thumb's in there like that, okay? And what happens is, most of the time, when you learn to bowl with a house ball, okay? And all house balls are drilled with these humongous holes in them, and you learn to squeeze. And I learned to bowl the same way. I squeezed, you know, just so, because that's all I knew, and I wanted to get heavier. And the heavier ball that you pick up, the bigger the holes, you squeeze even more. So then you go to approach it, and you say, okay, I want my own bowling ball. And they drill it to fit you, and it will not come off your hand, because they've measured you the way your thumb should be. So you go out and you get ready to throw it, you bend your thumb, you squeeze onto it like you do with your house ball, it won't come off. Okay, and you think, God, this is too tight. So you take it back, you say, make it bigger. So then you can see somebody like me and I fill it back up with tape. Because that's the one thing you want to try and learn to do, is to learn to let the ball hang on you. You don't want to have to hang on to the ball.
It seemed that most people were at the clinic to learn how to bowl like this, instead of like this. One of the tips that Barbara had was, once again, focusing on your target and not moving until your ball has reached the pins. If you wanted to find out how to hook the ball, and I always thought the object was to stop hooking the ball, well, Barbara had some advice on that also.
If you want the ball to hook and it doesn't, okay, all you have to do is point this finger. All you have to do. The ball will hook if you point this finger at your target, whatever you're looking at. It can't do anything else, okay? Because when your hand comes out of the ball, conventional or not, as long as you don't throw, you know, torpedoes, if you give it a chance, if you point your finger, if you point this finger, the ball will hook, and it'll always hook the same amount. The only way, reason the ball backs up is if your thumb's over here, okay? And if you do cheat and look up, and you cannot keep your eye on your target, you point this finger at the right side of any pin you're shooting at, and you shouldn't miss it.
After each of the two clinics, Barbara had all of the bowlers in attendance get up and bowl while she talked with them and offered pointers on how to improve their game. And finally, after the last clinic, it was the moment everyone had been waiting for. A tournament between the top three male finishers from a tournament held earlier and the top two women from the same tournament bowling with Barbara. Bowling for the men's team were Bent, Jeff, and Chris, and bowling along with Barbara for the women's team were Kristen and Dorta. After one game, the women were leading by a score of 566 to 469. The second game wasn't much better for the men, and after two, it was still in favor of the women's team, 1046 to 900. A third game was bowled, and after the third and final matchup, the women were still the champs, 1557 to 1323. Reporting for Sandy Spotlight, I'm Airman Diane Fisher.
Earlier this month, an unusual basketball game took place at the gym. I say unusual because, for once, it was a full-court game. Here's our very own ABS sports correspondent with that story.
This is Howard Hodsell substituting for the vacationing Howard Softsell, who is recovering from his last interview, as we once again bring you another installment of Narrow-Minded World of Sports. Let's quickly go to the Sonnenstrom Base Gym, where a heated contest was beheld to a capacity crowd as the 1015th Air Base Group pitted their strength and agility against the 2004th Information Systems Squadron with some help from friends in a basketball game. Highlighting the first half, the Informers quickly gained possession of the ball, leaving the group to defend their basket. The Informers, under the supervision of their mentor and coach, Captain Earl the Pearl Stafford. However, the good fortune would end as quickly as it came. Watch number one, Ted Thompson. Let's see that again on instant replay. Right there! It's plain to see he ran into some difficulty. At one point in the game, the players were confused as to which sport they were playing, and having decided it was not volleyball, they resumed normal play. It was the group who dominated the first half, much to the approval of the crowd. Despite a valiant attempt by the Informers to maintain a lead, the group led at the end of the first half, 37 to 20, much to the disapproval of the Pearl. During halftime entertainment by the group's cheerleader squad, the Informers were formulating a new strategy. In the second half, the Informers made a remarkable comeback with basket after basket. However, it wasn't enough to be victorious. The group won the scrimmage with a final score of 66 to 54. Like the true sportsmen they are, the Informers shook hands with the victors and all left the gym as friends until the next game. And by the old clock on the wall, I see our time is up for now. But join me again right here on this same station for more from the narrow-minded world of sports. I'm Howard Hardsell, reporting for Sunday Spotlight.
Well, that'll do it for the first edition of Sunday Spotlight. We hope you'll join us again next month. For the entire boater crew, I'm Airman Rick Sarche.
This has been Sandy Spotlight, a monthly program for the Sonderstrom community. If you have a story you'd like to see, call Airman First Class Rick Sarche at extension 657. Sandy Spotlight is an AFTV Channel 8 production.
The following program comes to you via satellite from AFRTS Los Angeles. This is AFTV 8, Sonderstrom Air Base, Greenland.